And then online, of course. Yeah, continue. It's always nice when this pops up. It's like, what is this in my screen? So we want to tell you a bit today about the process of organizing PB events that can be deliberative events. Of course, this is the overall process, and we're going into the first phase of the process today, so designing of the process. So here you see again some of the steps. So the design of the process, we include so the design and the inclusion accessibility, and also communications and recruitment. So for us, design is a crucial part for your PB. And when we talk about design, what do we actually what do we refer to? Because design is a very broad term that is used in many different occasions. We design to improve the delivery of an effective PB process. And there's a whole scope of things you can think of. So these are a summary. If you try to summarize what should be in your design, it's setting goals, a theme, a target group. So this can be, for example, some specific groups in society, but it can also be that you say, I want to reach a most representative sample in society. Then, of course, it's related to resources, so budget, funding, team, specific digital tools. And there's the skill, the co-design. Do you want to co-design with people in the community? Also the area you're thinking of, and the criteria, which we touched upon last week, and who can participate. Then the idea, type of idea generation. You already said a bit on this in the check-in, that some of you have some experience organizing focus groups or organizing sort of events that are more informal. Of course, here there's a specific goal you want to reach. So which methods would you use? Which would you use, for example, a World Cafe, or would you use a more like a citizen assembly style, where you really have experts coming in and telling about the PB experiments or experiments about the PB process. And also the type of voting. And this afternoon we'll go into the consensus and voting. So also join that, please. And then the length of the process. So is it gonna take months or weeks, and how many time commitments are there for people to join? And also making the process more innovative or building upon what is already being done. So a rough timeline, and actually this is, of course, open to discussion. Like you know all, I think we all know this, that it's super important to start way ahead so that you have time to really build the PB process and the events you want to organize. So we say here 3 to 4 months, but this is open. Like we can also say 4 to 6 months. So it differs per city and per region. If you want to have a very big PB, if it's going to be very, much focused around a certain topic or a difficult target group that you want to include, these are all considerations that we don't know right now. But this is sort of a rough schedule that you can hang on to. So 3 to 4 months ahead of the event, you establish your goals and objectives. So you, with your team together, you look at the objectives and what do you want to reach with this PB. And you can select the date of your event, if there's one event or maybe it's several events. And of course, there should be a sort of PB event master plan, as we call it. So looking at the venue, the cost, the catering, the fees also that you want to include. And then 2 months ahead, you can create the event budget. It can also be earlier, of course, but here there's a final budget created. Or if you look at the cost, what is needed to make this event happen? And then you start with a very important part, of course, where we will touch upon in a bit, and that is the publicity and the recruitment. So how do you find your participants and how do you find the right people? Then you arrange also your team. So this sometimes has to be done earlier because you also include your team to do the recruitment and publicity. So this means your organizers, your facilitators, also your speakers, because sometimes you want to have experts there who can share about the topic that the PB is about, or a certain policy expert, or maybe somebody from the university that is going to give a guest lecture. Or, well, it can be anybody. It can also be somebody from the community that is like a community ambassador. Then coordinate with your event suppliers also. So catering equipment, this is more like technical stuff. And this counts, of course, for both online and offline. Because online, yeah, there's technical stuff, but offline, I mean, there's also technical stuff. Then catering is, of course, not needed. But still think about all the accessibility needs that could be there. I will go into that with the inclusion part in a bit. Then I put here 1 month ahead. So there should be sort of a briefing for the team. So for example, the facilitators and the speakers. But this is regularly done also just before the event. So how we organize it mostly is that we have sort of a briefing 1 month ahead, so that people know what the plan is. And then 1 week ahead, or maybe some days ahead of the event, we have sort of a final briefing session with all facilitators. And in this briefing session, you go over the script in more detail and you divide the roles. And then you continue, of course, with recruitment in the meantime, and you share information with those who registered. So this is a rough timeline, right? This is, of course, I can make this list much longer, and we also can provide you with more detailed ones, but this is sort of a rough sketch. Then you can create also a checklist of this same list. Have you created everything that is needed? This list is also more extensive if you want, but for now, this is sort of the summary. Cost, I think you can all think of enough costs that are included, but just to put them here, room rental, food and beverages, equipment, compensation. This is specific for PB. So if you use sortition methods, for example, and you want to have a representative sample, you will probably pay people to join, or you will make sure there's a compensation or a gift voucher. So also think of this ahead and make sure that it's included in your budget. Also for speakers, you might need a fee if they are, for example, experts on a certain topic. Then there's, of course, travel costs and insurance. So this is the thing that we are sort of specialized in, design of the process and working with a team of facilitators on making sure this event is, well, very deliberative, and also that there's space for everybody to speak. So you see here time schedule, and it's just to show you the detail of the schedule, because we believe it's very important to have all details in there so that it's clear to all the team members, so the lead facilitator, but also the tech team. So this was an online event. I think this was Democracy Lab Scotland. And you can see here that we've written the start time, the end time, and also what is it about, the purpose of the session, and also the details. So what do you need to have included? So who admits people to the room? It's very detailed, and this also gives much clarity to local facilitators. So you don't leave anything out in the open for people to consider. So everything is actually thought about. So the level of detail is quite high. So this we call like a facilitator script or a timetable. Then a very important topic I want to touch upon today is inclusion. Here a quote by Susan Goldsman: inclusive design doesn't mean you're designing one thing for all people. You're designing a diversity of ways to participate so that everyone has a sense of belonging. So inclusion is, of course, a topic that is nowadays much talked about. And I think it's also needed because, of course, we still have a society which is divided and is not always inclusive to many. And as governments and researchers, I think we should take this into account more and more, or more and more. Like, it should not be a question even. Inclusion is just something that we focus on and that is normal to us. So here are bits from a book that was introduced in 2018. It's called Mismatch, How Inclusion Shapes Design. And Kate Holmes is the writer, and she declares that designing for inclusion starts with recognizing exclusion, actually. And the textbook, the definition of inclusive design is design for the full range of human diversity. So you can think of human diversity in many different ways, but also for cities, I think this is very relevant, because there's a lot of social design and design happening, which is not always in the full range of human diversity. So here, also, you can read again, when the mismatch occurs between our needs and the manner in which these touch points are designed, we experience frustration, or worse yet, exclusion. And I'm sure you all have experienced some sort of exclusion in your lives, or if you haven't, you know people that have experienced exclusion, sometimes by government, sometimes by companies, or sometimes by education. This focus on human diversity is really important to us. And also, when you think of inclusion, it's not only on diversity, but also on access to, or human diversity, but also access to technology. Of course, nowadays with COVID also, we're excluding easily, because everybody should be online. And this is not always easy for people with disabilities, or also vulnerable groups who have limited access to resources. So to be aware of this, and to also keep it in your design always in the first phase, or have a discussion with your team how you will tackle this. So a bit of facts and figures, which are also, of course, not complete. So there's also, I don't mention all the groups, and I'm not going to mention every part of inclusion that is needed, I would say, but this is some things to give you some thoughts about. So only 1 in 3 disabilities is visible, meaning that most people that we see, we don't know that there is a disability. So if you're only designing for the people who are blind or mobility impaired, you're missing out on 2/3 of the population. So it can be people maybe have anxiety or different ways of learning, dyslexia. There's, of course, all sorts of disabilities that can cause people not to join your events, or can cause people not to join the PB because they feel that they are not wanted there, or because they are the right people to answer their questions that you're asking them. And also a global trend of aging population. So this example is from the UK. By 2050, over 50% will be over 50. And of course, how can we take into account also the needs of elderly? So how can we make sure that our events are suitable for people that maybe don't have the digital skills or literacy that we have? And then there's also temporary hindrances. You can think of temporary disabilities, but also, for example, poverty. People have, in different times of their life, of course, different financial situations, or also illnesses. This can be many things. So some principles we take into account. First of all, reaching out and inviting underrepresented groups. So this is just number one. Reach out, invite people, make a list of people you think are relevant for your event. Send out invitations to organizations that you normally don't invite, or that you didn't think of. Ask colleagues who are working in the field, who would you invite, or who is important to you, or who have we missed out on last time? And then also offer digital support if needed. So this could be, for example, for the elderly people that I've just mentioned, but maybe also for youth. can be also for, can be for anybody any way, but offer this. So if people get in contact, always mention in your emails or in your conversations that there's support possible. For example, we have organized events where before the event we organized separate Zoom sessions, how to use Zoom, how to work with digital tools. So these kind of support can make a difference. Always ask for it if there's any needs there. Then the third one is about compensation. So I already touched upon that, I think, in a bit, but it's very relevant for these kind of processes where we ask people's input to have a compensation in place, especially if it's research focused. People tend to give up their time for events that they find relevant, right? That they are feeling that they will have an impact or that they believe in. But if it's not completely clear why they should join, and if it's not also maybe only for their personal interest, you have to think of compensations or vouchers to make sure that people will show up. And also for people that, for example, will need childcare support because they are parents, or for example, because they have to work normally on the day you are asking them and they will miss out on income. So these are also things to take in consideration. Then also have a sign language translator or transcriptor. We also have used many times sign language translators, transcriptions. So if you want to have any tips on that specifically, we can of course support you there. And it works very well with online, actually. It was very good to see that so many people of the deaf community last time we organized an event joined, and they were also inviting more people. So if there's one person, most likely it will be that there can be more people, for example, with hearing impairment joining. And then also have a breakout room or a quiet room at every event for people who might have to go to this room or have a chat with you because they feel not well or because they feel over, people that are maybe highly sensitive or people that need some quiet time in between the discussions. And of course, people have different needs, so make your event interactive and engage them in a different way than just organizing events for your own colleagues. For example, have practical exercises, have icebreakers in there. We will go a bit into this also in the facilitation training, when we will explain some activities that you could do to make it more interactive. And this is very obvious, but do more work with marginalized or excluded groups if you can. So of course, this is, this work is very important, the PB work, but for really getting to know communities that you normally don't reach, it's important that you don't just do it during PB, but that you already build up the relationships before, because it takes time. It just always takes time, and more time than you would expect, to let people trust you, to make sure that they will spread your message and spread your invitation also. And once you have their trust, is my experience that it's very normal to reach out to them, and they will also even reach out to you to invite you for events, or they will ask you for invitations for, oh, can we think along again? So this relationship building is actually quite vital and important to reaching out to different groups. And of course, then also it's all very, very common knowledge, I would say, but provide the information in a timely manner. So some people need time to read or process some of the content, and others wouldn't even read it and don't need it. But for those who do, offered on time. And also the time of the day which you organize it. Think of evenings or weekends, but it can also be, for example, that it would be before work hours. So early morning breakfast meetings or lunch meetings. And also test this out. So when you organize an event and you do it for the first time in the evening, also check, do a sort of a pilot event. Check it with the people who joined. Is this a convenient time? Is this working for you? Did people show up? If they don't show up, ask them why. Was it the timing? Was it another sort of practical issue? So these are all quite sort of fairly simple tricks you can do before your event to make sure that people will join. Before I continue, are there any questions until now? No, it's all clear. Okay, let me know if there are. So we go a bit more in depth into the design of the digital events, but I will go over this fairly quickly because I think it's saying it all in the text. So you can think of specifically for audio, you can think of voiceovers or podcasts. Of course, also video options. So maybe explaining how to do how to join the PB event or how to do the voting. You can think of braille, but also digital flexibility. So walk in the user's shoes. I've just discovered there's an app that you can install, and it will show you how a digital platform looks like for a person, for example, with a disability or with, for example, with autism, or a person, for example, with dyslexia. So you can try this out after this workshop and see for yourself, how does the digital world look like for others? How would they read, for example, texts, and how would they perceive your event? And apart from that, you can also use digital assistance tools. I've put here some text-to-speech or transcription tool. So there's HappyScribe, Sonics, and Otter. So there's many digital tools being developed for all sorts of assistance. So look into it. And if you need tips on that, we also have a huge list of tools. So let us know and we can share and think along. And of course, you have options or choices embedded. So you might have the option of making text bigger or smaller. This is, of course, specifically for the digital events nowadays. Then a bit more on speaking. We say language is fluid, so everything we say now today is maybe tomorrow used differently. So be aware of terminology or be aware of definitions. They might change. Also for PB, I think it's quite important to invite people that are speakers that speak in a way that is understandable for people, that is not too academic, that is giving space for an open discussion. And also before you let the PB speaker, for example, present, that they can send you the text or the presentation and you can check if there's not too many jargon, or for example, terminology that is not used in like daily life. And then also when you speak to people, refer to them as people. And this is also very sort of, simply put, but I think it's very important to mention this, not their characteristic is what counts, but their, first of all, being a person. So their gender or sexual orientation or religion or racial group, you don't normally refer to that unless it's specifically needed, but then still it's a characteristic. So you always mention it as a characteristic. And also universal phrases. So that again goes about jargon, taking out jargon or terminology that is used only by, for example, professionals. And then here it's being said, also recognize the impact of mental health language. What do we mean by that? So mental health language is, for example, talking about autism or ADHD or being bipolar. This all will be for people, can be offensive to people. And it's also good to be aware of this. So to stay away from using these terminologies, because people can be in this group, maybe feeling that they're excluded. And I think it's very common nowadays to use these mental health terminologies very regularly. And we should be aware that it's not always needed and it's not always wished also for a open and good discussion. And also the same counts for using gender neutral language. So for example, not saying guys or welcome to all the ladies and the men, but using more open and more gender neutral terminology, like just welcoming everybody in the room, welcome to all people. And if you're not sure about something, because again, language is fluid and we all change and society changes quickly, ask around your colleagues, like how would they approach these kind of topics? Or if you have somebody in your close surroundings with a specific need or a specific characteristic, ask this person, how would you like to be approached? What is your experience there? Of course, this is also something, it can be something that is also talked in your organization about, or maybe you want to open up the conversation because it hasn't been talked about. So I would encourage you to open these conversations and have chats with your colleagues about this. And then a bit about language barriers. Of course, this is also counting for people with either, for example, an education that was lower, or for example, people that have dyslexia. Here you can see that about 10% of population, this is all UK numbers, by the way, has dyslexia, and 4% with severe cases. It can also be migrants who are new in the country, or it can be people who are expats that don't speak the local language. Of course, there's many different language barriers that can happen, but be aware that this is not always obvious and people have to overcome it, and you can support them on this overcoming. And apart from language barriers, of course, everybody learns different and everybody processes information differently. So how can you make sure that people are able to join your event and learning and processing the right information? This is a bit of tips that I won't go into detail too much because I think it says it all, but be aware of also written texts, how you can improve your written text also using the right font and size. Don't make it too unclear, make it big enough, and have use the right colors, and presentations always have short text, wide margins, clear headings. This is all very common knowledge, but I think in general, as cities and also as academics, we tend to use a lot of text, like I did also in this presentation again, but I think it's okay for you because you are used to that. But for the general public, this would be way too much text. So I would take out half of the text and just put maybe one picture. Sometimes one picture says it all, and you explain a whole story around this picture, or you use this picture as a starting point. But I always, when I'm in sort of general public presentations or in PB events, if there's people with too lengthy or too texty presentations, people will just not get it. Or people will, of course, some people will, but please, please take out the half of your text at least, or be aware of colleagues that sent you a presentation that only contains text. Feel free to share with them. Half of the people don't read it. half of people are maybe going to skip your presentation if you present it like this. And also the writing style or the tone of voice. Have easy wording, but also short sentences, and avoid jargon again. And there's a lot of websites where you can check also the words you're using. For example, for the Netherlands, I know Is It Bijeen? That's one website where you can check, are your terminologies, are they considered to be B1 level of Dutch? And for the UK, there's also a plain English sort of website where you can check. So I'm sure also in your local context, there is these kind of websites. So do always check your writing. And then also for posters, use graphics and ask a graphic designer to support you with it, because of course it helps so much to make your text or your writing more understandable. Okay, that was my first sort of part on inclusion. Before we continue, I would like to have a moment together again to just